Hi everyone, it's been 2 years since I've become an aircraft owner. And just after I purchased the aircraft, I did a full refurbishment and I also made a video on the purchase itself. But it's been a few months since I've actually gotten a chance to give you an update, just generally on how things are going and what it's like having owned this aircraft for 2 years. More specifically, I want to talk about an avionics upgrade and the experience and why I did what I had to do. Okay, so it's a bit ironic. If you watch the video that I made about the aircraft purchase, I said that an avionics upgrade would be nice to have at some point in the future.
I wanted to improve the instrument panel too. Of course, doing all glass would be great, but that is very big money and maybe one day.
I just didn't quite think that the future would arrive so soon. And I was kind of forced to make a few decisions. What happened was I was flying back into Johannesburg. Just as I got into Johannesburg special rules, and if you're familiar with the Johannesburg airspace, that's 7,500 feet or below. And I probably was at about 7,000 feet, and I got called up by the traffic information service, which was odd because they speak to you in the information region, not in Johannesburg special rules. So they got on the radio and they said, Zulu, Sierra, Delta, Echo, Delta, you're on frequency. And of course, I'm like, yes, Zulu, Sierra, Delta, Echo, Delta here, go ahead. And the controller proceeded to say, what is your altitude that you're flying at? And I said, look, I'm at 7,000 feet. And she told me that they are picking me up on my transponder at about 14,000 feet. So, of course, this is a big problem because if you're in the Johannesburg area at 14,000 feet, you are in the Johannesburg TMA or the Class C airspace. And you're going to be disrupting and shouldn't be up there. So besides, of course, thinking that, hey, this is quite a compliment, you know, I'm going to have to need some supplemental oxygen and other things to fly up that high. But I wasn't, and this has caused some, clearly some panic at the information service. To the point where she actually asked me, hey, just change your transponder from mode C to mode A so that it stops transponding the incorrect altitude. I had the transponder looked at, got it back in service, I did another flight, and exactly the same thing went down on the return leg again. So clearly something time-bound that causes the transponder to transmit the incorrect altitude to air traffic control. So I knew I had to replace the transponder. And there's also this upcoming law, I believe it's in 2025 for South Africa, that you have to have an ADS-B capable transponder, which is a good thing in my opinion, because this allows you to see traffic information in the cockpit and you're transmitting that information for others that have the equipment to receive in their cockpit. So it really helps a lot with regards to situational awareness and also the busy airspace in Johannesburg. So this led me down the path of having a discussion with my avionics shop and getting some quotations, primarily for a Garmin GNX 375. So if you're familiar with the Garmin suite, it's essentially a ADS-B transmitter, but it also has a GPS. And since my aircraft currently only has a removable ARIA 660 GPS, I went for the GNX 375 because it would be an important foundation to get the aircraft IFR certified for the long term. So instead of just doing the transponder, it gives me the opportunity to actually do something meaningful that I can invest and get some return in the future. Now, if you've done any avionics upgrade, or for that matter, like any computer type upgrade, if you've been into computer components like I used to be, you know, these things have got huge scope creep. It's like you buy one thing and then you think to yourself, well, maybe I could just as well do something else while I'm at it. And things add up very quickly. So when I did the GNX 375 quote, the other thing that came up for me around safety, since I'm not going to address the situational awareness, I also wanted to address the fact that I'm flying a single piston engine. If something happens to that engine, it's a problem. And I fly my family around a lot. So I said, since they're getting into the aircraft panel, let me get a JPI 830. So this is an engine monitoring system. It literally has exhaust gas temperature probes on each one of the six cylinders. It also has cylinder head temperature on each one of the cylinders. which is critical information that could give you a heads up in case something is going to go wrong. And in fact, since the JPI has actually saved me from making two takeoffs, just purely because I could see that there was something wrong with the magnetos very, very clearly. So in any case, so at the time I said, GNX, let me do the JPI. And then in the discussion with the avionics guys, they're like, well, why don't you just get two G5s? You know, so the G5 is a replacement of the AH, the artificial horizon, and the directional indicator in the aircraft. And it puts it into more of a solid state, so you don't need the vacuum system that actually comes coupled with the engine that spins the gyros for the AH and the DI to work. So if you don't need that, you can actually remove the entire vacuum system, which I think is a good thing to do. So I said, okay, well, let's go ahead and do that as well. And then, of course, one thing would lead to another. And the other big problem I had was that I only had one radio. And it's a very old radio. It's actually the original King radio that came with Zulu Sierra Delta Echo Delta. And the problem with the radio having only one comm is that you can't listen in on another frequency. And in the Johannesburg airspace, especially Rand Airport, it's a small controlled area right next to OR Tambo. And as you fly out, just out of the Rand Airport controlled airspace, you're into Johannesburg special rules. So I said, let me get another radio. And I went for a Trig radio. It was between that or a Garmin radio. The Trig was slightly less expensive, and it has a nice sort of playback function. If you missed something on the radio, you could listen back to that. So there I was now doing quite a few things avionics-wise. And then the final two things that I actually said, let me just do it whilst the aircraft is now essentially going to be out of service for weeks to do the upgrades that I've discussed. And the one was to get strobe lights, as my aircraft before didn't have strobe lights. Again, a safety consideration. And the other thing is an ELT, or an emergency locator transmitter, I guess. And you need that, especially for international flights. So you're not going to be allowed to fly into Botswana or Namibia, apparently, if you don't have an ELT. And again, my aircraft didn't have one. So I added in those two additional components as well. This became a fairly big avionics upgrade. I remember having a discussion with the avionics guys about the autopilot. I have an old SDEC 30 system that essentially is able to be coupled with the GPS as well as the directional indicator. And it does altitude hold, which is actually super nice, especially if you come from school aircraft. Having an autopilot is awesome. But we had this discussion around the Garmin 500 series autopilot, which would just couple so nicely with the new Garmin equipment. And I said, okay, this is now got to stop somewhere. This is just not going to happen right now. So I didn't pursue the autopilot at the time. And I also remember having a discussion about my audio panel. Now, the audio panel is a simple piece of equipment that literally just connects your radio to different connections, or your headset to different connections. Either you're on COM 1 or on COM 2, or you're going to be on the navigational radio, making sure that you're tuned into the right frequency. But it's a simple piece of equipment, and mine worked absolutely fine. It also has an intercom component to that, which allows you to have all four seats with headsets. You can't communicate in there if you don't have a headset. These small aircraft are extremely noisy. So I said, let's not touch the audio panel. The whole upgrade took probably about 3 months. This was 2023, September to end of November. I was so excited to get the aircraft back. I remember going on a test flight and making sure that everything was working and everything checked out and looked pretty great. So I'm making this recording now in May 2024, and with the aircraft being a 1974, it's actually her 50th birthday. So happy birthday to Zulu Sierra Delta Echo Delta. Thanks so much for watching. Please subscribe for the future content, and please let me know what you'd like to see more of. And thanks for watching.